Yeah, there was an article in the wire about how in Gujarat there are lots of leaders who are from the Dalits, from the OBCs and other. But actually in the Muslims, there is absolutely no leader, because they said that all the ones who are maybe a little powerful, I mean financially okay, economically okay, still nobody wants to get involved. So even though, so I would like to know a little more about that, because actually I was a little wondering about that. Thank you.
You know, one of the things that the BJP has tried to demonstrate is the electoral irrelevance of the Muslim community. They have said we will not put up a single candidate. We are still the second largest or the third largest Muslim country in the world. But such a large segment of people will not be represented, and we can still come to power. And within this frame, I've been hearing, not just in Gujarat, but you know, after the UP elections, there's been a series of discussions within the Muslim community. I'm invited to a lot of these discussions, and they're heartbreaking discussions, because people are saying Muslims should withdraw from Indian politics. For a generation, let secular Hindus fight the battle. If we come in forward, it's only going to make politics even more divided. So it is, there's a sense of the despair that I spoke about, not just about the possibility of justice, but also the possibility of dignified participation in India's political life, seems to have also got eroded. So in this council of despair, the idea is that let us just concentrate quietly on making a living and doing our day-to-day work and keeping our head as low as possible and not being visible. So if that is not second-class citizenship, I don't know what it is. And we must remember that the RSS, Golwalkar actually has written extensively about his vision for India, which is in India in which Muslims and Christians will be allowed to live, but only as second-class citizens with no rights. I have worked intensely in Gujarat for 15 years, and I believe that Muslims in Gujarat today are living as second-class citizens. They want to hide their identity. I am traveling on an auto rickshaw. I can make out that this is an auto rickshaw driven by a Muslim, because there will be no religious symbols. Things like that. You go to a dhaba, you'll find names like Tulsi and Ekta, etc. Again, with no sign, you know, you're wanting to hide your identity in order to survive, or you go into ghettos, which are underserved. So I think that, you know, precisely, I think all of this is the unmaking of India. If we don't resist it, and the idea that this is a battle that Muslims have to fight by themselves is a completely wrong one. The idea that the Muslim has to withdraw from all visible participation in resistance of any kind is one of great despair.
So, my question is whether this, I'm Prem Kumar, I'm studying in School of Law, SRM University. So whether this cowbelt syndrome, whether we call this syndrome as a cowbelt syndrome, because basically when we take Tamil Nadu, especially the Dravidian states, we are not susceptible to these kind of ideas or these kind of violence or these kind of violent instincts. When you take Tamil Nadu, or when you take Andhra or Kerala or Karnataka, we are not so much susceptible as the cowbelt is. And when you take the power sharing, and since you've been talking long about the constitutional principles that are at stake, that's justice, liberty, equality, fraternity. So it is a responsibility of the government to take the affairs of those affairs. The government which is now heading at the Delhi is properly representing these bills. None of our states are representing the cabinet power. That means that there are no minister from Tamil Nadu, no minister from Andhra, no minister from Karnataka, no minister from Kerala. All these peninsular states are somewhat, they've been isolated. And the power belt and the power structure that now holding in Delhi is purely representing the belt, which is actually creating all these problems, which is actually creating a threat to the idea. So whether we look this point, like these states who are coming under the cow belt are perpetuating this kind of problems. Whether we have to take the sociological readings of those states, or we have to reflect this is an idea of India.
I'm not sure. Karnataka is very much part of this story, certainly. Karnataka, I've been going to, in fact, the idea of love jihad, the idea of love jihad was actually created first. First, the word was coined by the Catholic Bishop Conference of Kerala. They first coined the idea of love jihad. For many years, whole of coastal Karnataka has been racked by this initial acts of lynching, etc. So Karnataka certainly is not free of this kind of climate. Kerala, we are seeing changing before our eyes. West Bengal, I was there recently. We're seeing an extraordinary phenomenon in West Bengal of large-scale exodus of CPM cadres into the BJP. And it raises, I'm told that we will not at all be surprised if the second largest party after the Trinamool is going to be the BJP. I can't understand what kind of left consciousness was created if it was possible for those cadres to walk away one day from CPM to BJP. In Kerala, we are seeing a rising climate of divisiveness. Many parts of the Northeast, Assam and many parts of the Northeast, please remember, one of the worst incidents of lynching happened in Nagaland. Nagaland is a place where, we saw, this is the one place where a 35-year-old Muslim man was charged with rape. And the crowd broke into the jail. They broke down the walls of the jail. They pulled the man out from inside jail. They stripped him naked, they paraded him, and they hung him in a public lynching. Nagaland is 95-98% Christian. So I think that let us recognize that there is a poisonous air these days in Delhi, and so I've also escaped it for a day. But there's a much greater poison that I think is spreading across the land, and it is, it's great if the Dravidian states are somewhat resistant to this, but I don't think you are protected, and that we should be complacent.
There is any difference, is there is any coincidence, whether these models will reflect in any part of India, like social engineering, which was done in UP.
Yeah. I think that the Gujarat model had two aspects. One of them was a model of development which is centered around enormous public support to big business. So the subsidies that Tatas and Adanis have got from public funds is mind-boggling, at the expense of investments in healthcare and education and so on. So that's one part of the model which we are trying to expand across the country. But the other part of the Gujarat model inseparably was of reducing, creating a social divide on communal lines in a way that even Dalits forget their other oppressions and they join ranks with upper caste Hindus against the common enemy, which is the Muslim, and in tribal areas, the Christian. And I think that model was very successfully used in UP, both in the general election, that's how Muzaffarnagar, etc. was happened, and even more successfully now. And I think that with Adityanath's anointment as chief minister, all masks, all fig leaves have been thrown to the winds. We still had apologists who said, actually Modi doesn't want all of this to happen and he wants development and these are people who are speaking out against his wishes. We can accuse Mr. Modi of many things, but I don't think you can accuse him of weakness. And if he did not wish for all of this to happen, he would have been able to stop it long, long time ago. But even then, if there was any doubts, when you choose a man who is sort of who's the ultimate rabble rouser in terms of hate speech, hate culpable criminal hate violence, and the founder of a militia, a private militia, and becomes the chief minister, selected, then I don't think there's any doubt about what the model for electoral success in our country that is being propounded is today. It is basically one built around extreme communal polarization. And the Dalit is really important because its success and failure will depend on whether the Dalit joins hands with upper caste Hindus against the Muslim, or joins hands with the Muslim against upper caste casteism and communalism. I think that is really will decide the future of Indian politics.
My name is Kosal Raman. Is it time to rewrite the constitution? Because we think we have an oath to have the power of vote, but looks like, you know, either a thief or a robber comes every 4 or 5 years. Number two, is the police reforms possible, and is the judicial reforms possible these days? Thank you, sir.
I think that India's constitution is not perfect. There are some flaws in it, but it is the best that we have. It's our strongest defense. And the four values that I spoke about, justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, is something that we need to hold on to. We need to hold on to the secular idea of equal respect and so on. So I would be very frightened about any idea about rewriting India's constitution. I think it is our best defense against the unmaking of India itself. Police reforms, judicial reforms, etc., in a climate of where, what are we seeing happening with the police? Or when the police has become an arm, an extension of the political agenda so openly of the state, during this Karwan, the way we saw how police was used, police and the Gau Rakshak are more or less, you can't even distinguish between them. They all act together, and they work together. But having worked within the IAS for about 17 years, I want to only underline one thing, though, that it is very, very often we blame the police, the lower police force, for being communalized, and therefore they're helpless. I mean, the country is helpless because what can we do if the police force is less educated, less trained, and so on. My experience very strongly has been that it is the leadership. The leadership of the police and the leadership of the civil service, the IAS, and the political leadership, which is critical. And I have worked with exactly the same police and been able, in communal rights situations, to have them act with complete fairness. So it's an alibi to blame them for what is happening.
I got a question, actually. You spoke about America, right? During the time of Jim Crow laws, when the lynching were taking place, It was the ordinary people of America, the working class, both the white and the blacks, together, they fought against it. Okay. See, there were laws. Even before that, the abolition of slavery was 50, 60, 70 years old. But still, it was in practice after the consciousness among the people and the working class forces coming together. And the reflection of which you saw in the civil rights movement. Yeah. Even now, you're speaking about Trump, but just a few months before Trump, it was Bernie Sanders, a left-wing politician, who just conquered the minds of the young people in America. Again, there is this force coming in, the ordinary working people, the blacks, the whites, the Latinos, and everyone, they're coming and rallying behind this leader who stood against this establishment. See, the question you posed, yes, we are silent, maybe because we don't realize our collective potential. So there is a collective force which actually challenged Modi when we saw the working class people coming for a general strike action, 180 million people in Swat against Modi, rallying means stalling in his plans for labor reforms. So with that big force in here, why there are many activists, not even pinpointing that force? That is the positive area where people, irrespective of the religion, irrespective of the caste, coming together galvanizing themselves as a force standing against the establishment.
If there's any hope, it is by working people coming together across community and caste and providing resistance. I believe that not enough of that is happening in India. I see hope in that direction, but I don't see a Bernie Sanders in India today. And somebody like Bernie Sanders, it's extraordinary because he could have given the speech that I was given. He was speaking about similar things. He talked about compassion. He talked about solidarity, and young people. And he was 10 years older than me, even a less charismatic speaker than I am. But he was a rock star for young people across America, and that was because in India we still have to throw up a set of leaders who articulate those ideas with the kind of credibility that Bernie Sanders was able to. But I do believe that is going to happen one day. But I'll point out one difference, though, and I think it's an important difference. In America, white Americans who've had the benefit of a college education have tended to be far more liberal and haven't voted for Trump. In India, it is the very opposite. It is people who have had the benefit of a college education and more are the ones who are most likely to be communal and casteist and anti-woman. And the highest proportion of people who continue to hold, in the way of life, a more liberal and accepting and tolerant perspective in social relations are people who've had the least education. So I think that is also places in my mind that we as a social class are actually much more part of the problem in India than they are in the US.
You spoke of the climate of divisiveness, climate of hate in the country, which we all are aware of. Do you think it's so ingrained in the people here that no matter, irrespective of whichever party comes to power, it will continue, it will stay, or do you have a hope for change?
No, ma'am, what I was saying was that what the present regime has exposed is the fact that, as I said, the aquifers of hatred that I never suspected existed. I've had many sort of arguments with my friends over many years where I used to say, I am convinced the majority of Indians, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, are secular by conviction, secular in the Indian sense of equal respect for all faiths, etc. This is the first time when I'm getting a little, more than a little, shaken in that conviction. Are we the majority? Are we a minority? But there are still enough people in India who will stand up and resist. I'm dismayed by the silences. I'm losing hope, and I'm not one who easily loses hope.
Good evening, sir. First of all, I'd like to place on record my gratitude to CAG for having had the courage to bring you here and make you speak to us. This is fabulous for Madras. As a seventh generation Tamilian born here, my family has always been secure, Muslim or whatever, that we are safe. The values of Periyar and socio-capitalism and a mix of education and music have always kept us Muslim, Indian, happy. But you just said whatever's happening in the cow belt is eventually going to affect us. You've already stated about Karnataka and Kerala. We also know that these forces are knocking at our door. How do we, as Tamilians, as Indians, keep that at bay, keep that hatred at bay? That's my question.
I think it's the most important question of the evening and one that I know too little about this part of the world, the country, to be able to respond. I can respond in more general ways. On the issue of the cultural, the cultural question of the cow, the bullfight, we had tens of thousands of young people coming out. I'm still waiting for the day when people would come out in that, in the same, with the same kind of passion, when there's violence and hatred against, targeted against Dalits and Muslims and minorities. I think that we need to, the kinds of conversations we've had today, we have to have them openly all the time with young people. I think we've kept silent far too long. When I talked about chronicling and speaking out, I wrote somewhere, I want your conscience to ache unbearably. I will not stop. You all wanted to hear me. I'm grateful. Some of you may not. But I will speak. And I will continue to speak. And I will continue to speak till our consciences ache unbearably. I think we just, I mean, for me, it is about confronting the issue, naming the issue, and reflecting with, especially with our young people, about what is your imagination for Tamil Nadu? Would you like when Gandhiji said that India would be emptied out of its soul if Muslims have to live in India with fear? Can we have the courage to make that conversation, to have that conversation in this state? And if we don't, I think the poison will enter, will spread, and our silences will enable it, and our culpabilities will be through our silences.
I think in the name, wait. In the name of fairness, equality, I should give the mic. No. Firstly, the young man I stopped before, and then afterwards I will.
Check. So I have two questions, quick questions. You talked about the constitutional values. So I'm just curious to know, forget about the last 3 years. Are you saying, is that your contention that in the last 67 years before that, the values of justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity have been guaranteed and protected? And also as a side, what about our neighbors in Pakistan, and Bangladesh, and Burma, and Sri Lanka, have they been protected? So if it's not, then what's new? Why the grave face suddenly? Is my question. The second question is, you talk about reservoirs of hatred and how the leaders, the current leaders, are not responsible for this hatred. So I'm just wondering, isn't the hatred and the intolerance and the gruesome violence and cruelty kind of mutual? Because you have somebody who's done a PhD in the Quran, Islamic studies, Baghdadis, talking about killing all the non-believers, which is something that's echoed, that's echoing like from the north also. So I'm just wondering, isn't it mutual? Aren't you being not objective? Thank you.
Good, strong questions. I do not believe that 67 years represented a defense of these constitutional values. I have been a very strong and vocal critic of much of what has happened in these 67 years. I do believe that the Congress Party has, as far as the secular question is concerned, has been opportunistic in its appeasement of communal elements, both of the Hindu and the Muslim faith. People often talk about the Congress Party as having followed a policy of appeasement of Muslims, and I think that is completely false. The Muslim people have never been appeased, because if they had, they would not be, you know, at the the two most disadvantaged communities, the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes, and Muslims are more or less have the same development indicators. It is not the Muslim community that has been appeased, but communal elements, both of the Hindu faith and the Muslim faith, that have been appeased. That is why Congress governments have gone in for cow slaughter laws and for anti-conversion laws and its role in communal. But the difference between a party which is opportunistically communal and a party for whose whose central ideology is anti-minority is still different. And I was talking about the qualities of leadership that we were seeing around time, this new climate of fear, the legitimizing of hatred and bigotry, the amplification of this bigotry, the moral inversion that I spoke about. All of this is something that has got much more aggravated in recent years. But there is certainly a continuation in many ways from the past. And about the second, I didn't even couldn't quite understand what you were talking about, a PhD in, I think the very idea, and if that's what, if that, let me just say, yeah. See, Islam, okay. The idea that we have that Islam is a religion or a tradition which historically or in contemporary times has a particular carries a particular burden of violence which other communities and traditions do not have is a complete falsehood, and it is something that has been propagated, I mean, just historically, empirically. Each of our traditions, we look at the Hindu tradition to which we belong, the idea of caste is the only organized major religion in the world which justifies inequality and has justified the oppression of disadvantaged people. I'm only mentioning this because every religious tradition has had, and every cultural tradition has had many flaws. I remember lecturing somewhere in the United States, in a university in the United States, on something similar some years ago. And somebody stood up, a Jewish young man stood up actually, and asked almost an identical question to the one that you asked. And it was interesting because I told him, I said, you know, two or three things. One is that if we believe what you are saying is that, in effect, you're saying that if I belong to a community which has in history or some people of my identity have done something that is wrong, then I am somehow vicariously responsible for it. If you accept that principle, I said, then every upper caste Hindu, for instance, should not be alive. And certainly no man should be alive. I mean, all women should be free to attack men because of what they've done across history. If you accept this principle of vicarious responsibility. But even if you look at just what are the actual legacies that we carry, I was standing in the United States. I mean, the United States has committed the genocide of the American Indian community. It has enslaved half a continent. It has it has done so many things, but why should I hold any American today responsible to carry those burdens? And finally, the idea that terrorism is something that is specific to people of Muslim identity is empirically wrong. If you look at the official data just for India, the percentage of people, civilians killed by terror violence from 2000 to today, except within the year 2008, caused by people of Muslim identity is about 10% of all deaths. And that is less than even their share in India's population. Many of us receive a message saying, you know, all Muslims are not terrorists, but all terrorists are Muslims, and we nod our heads. But the father of our nation and two prime ministers in India were killed by terror violence. None of the people who killed them were Muslim, and yet we'll nod our heads. So ultimately, I believe that if you want to believe in prejudice, there's a very nice phrase in Hindi, which I'll translate, which basically says you can wake up somebody who is awake. How do you wake up you can wake up somebody who's asleep. How do you wake up somebody who's awake? So if I want to hold a prejudice about a community, then whatever I can, I mean, I have written a whole book about this. I can spend hours giving you fact by fact. Do Muslims have larger families? Do Muslims, are they reproductively irresponsible? Are they, serial divorcees, divorcers, and so on and so forth. The whole set of stereotypes, are they sexual predators? We have a whole set of anti-Muslim stereotypes that we have created, which are not empirically correct. But the point is not, is if you were just misled, no, I'm not talking about you, if people were generally misled and had these things because they were not, then you were sleeping, I can wake you up with some facts. But if you are not interested in the facts and you will continue to carry those prejudices, then how do I wake you up if you're awake?
I'm so glad to have made it here to hear you. It's absolutely a great delight. The thing is, as a kid growing up in Madras, my country, I never had to question my Indianness, nor did I have to prove it. But for the past few years, I have actually tried to unconsciously or subconsciously have to prove my Indianness. And there has been a question asked to my husband from one of his friends, are you a Muslim first or are you an Indian first? And the thing is, the growing insecurity which is growing inside me makes me actually think so many things. I'm trying to rationalize why it is that the Hindutva movement is so strong today. And is it because Pakistan was made on the basis of a Muslim country? And is that what the Hindutva movement wants to bring, that we have every right, if Pakistan was made on a Muslim country, we have every right to bring the same glory of Hindutva back to this land? And I had recently heard Dr. Ram Punyanian, he told us that, I mean, when I asked him the question, he said, unless you Muslims have a huge movement where you have Dalits on your side, where you have the minority on your side, there is no hope for you. It seems to be a downward spiral. And that was very despairing, especially for a young person like me, where I'm so proud of my India, of being an Indian, and to have to actually go back home and, you know, cry on my pillow and say, okay, I guess I'm not going to be happy. I don't have a great future in my own country, and having to always prove. And I have so many friends who are blind supporters of the BJP, highly educated, extremely rich people, well-traveled, well-educated. And when I speak to them about why it is demonetization, absolutely nothing. GST, no. Communalism, no, nothing. I mean, everything is absolutely, you know, it's not, there's like a parda is there over the head, and they feel that I'm overreacting. So my question is, as what today the Hindutva movement is a product of 70 years of brainwashing and a programmatic movement, a very well planned brainwashing of the people. Is there any hope to even undo it? What would it take another 70 years for us Muslims to feel safe in our own country? Where is the hope? Do I have to go back in despair again today?
I believe this is not a battle that Muslims have to fight alone. It's as important a battle for me as it is for you. Do I want my child to grow up in a country where a segment of people are made to feel the way that you are being forced to feel? It diminishes India for me as much as it diminishes it for you. So it is our collective battle. That is the first thing that I want to say. The idea that there's a contradiction somehow between being Muslim and being Indian is a terrible canard which we have to battle and resist. I'm reminded, you know, a very close friend is a professor called Professor Bandukwala. Some of you might know him. He was a professor in Baroda University, and his heart broke into pieces, I think, could never join again, because when his home was burnt down in the university, his own students were part of the mob which set his home on fire. He's a very gentle, kind man, and he often talks. And so he was telling me once, he said that I feel so lonely, a bit like you were talking, but he was saying, I feel so lonely in my country today. He says, when my Hindu friends tell me, Dr. Bandukwala, you're so nice, you're almost like a Hindu. And he says that, they don't understand that, why can't I be completely Muslim and be nice, you know, and so on. But he says that to my Muslim friends, I have a question. And my question is that are we right in our belief that ours is the only path to heaven? So he says, I asked them, this is Bandukwala, he says, I asked them, Jannat mein, in heaven, would Gandhiji have entry or not? And if your answer is that he will not have entry into Jannat, then I also don't want to go into that Jannat at all. And my Muslim friends are unhappy with me, so I feel very lonely. This is what he was telling me. And I think that it is, you know, this kind of dilemma about how can I negotiate my love for my religious identity and respect for every other religion and a full participation as an equal Indian in every way is a very difficult one in the climate that has been created. This is not the India that was envisaged in the freedom struggle nor in the constitution. But the Hindutva never reconciled. People don't even, you know, when I was talking about Gandhiji's last months, it's not even a, it's I think it's a story that we need to tell over and over again to young people. I, just out of interest, I go and ask young people, how did Gandhiji die? And why was he killed? And no one in no class has been told this story that I told. They're always told that either they don't even talk about him being killed, or they say he was killed because he acceded to partition, which is a complete distortion of the, he was killed because he spoke about love and that this country belongs equally to all, even when there was a raging tempest of hatred, and he stood up to that. And this last battle, his last battle was actually the one that I described, 2 weeks before he was killed. And he was killed because of this last battle, because he made sure that every mosque went back to Muslims and every Muslim home in Delhi went back to its original Muslim residence. So it is. And lastly, I have a Muslim, a lot of young Muslim colleagues work with me. I saw this one of my Muslim colleagues, a young man. I found he had gone into almost like a depression. And I used to see him at work, and I sat him down one day and I said, son, why are you, you know? So he spoke a lot about, exactly like you were speaking, he said, and he kept telling me, however much I love my country, I will always be a minority in this country. I'm reminded now, and I'm reminded over and over again, and he talked about, say, I think each of you all will have stories. There was a cricket match, and I had the only television set in my house, and all my Hindu friends were there, and when Pakistan won, they turned to me and said, oh, you'll be very happy, and so on. So I realized how much I love my country. I'll always be a minority, etc. And it's got much worse now. My reply to him, and that is my reply to you, my reply to him was that I can understand your anguish completely. But the only thing I disagree with you is that you're a minority in this country. Because I will accept that you're a minority in this country if I believe that the real fight in this country is between Hindus and Muslims. But that is not the fight. The fight in India is between people who misuse religion for hatred and those who follow their own faith and respect the right of other people to follow their faith. And we belong to the latter group, and we are the majority community in this country. And so there's no reason for you to despair. You belong to the majority community in this country. We need to stand together more strongly. We need to be conscious of ourselves as the majority community in this country. Yeah. But we won't allow, till I'm standing, I will not allow the voice to go.
Good evening, sir.
Before. I was quite generous, so. But if you want, okay. Before I say what I really want to say, I would like to point out that I don't want to end the discussion. That's not my role today, but maybe some of the words might go into that direction. So what I really want to say is that at least in the 3.5 years that I've been here directing this institute, we have
had many phenomenal discussions and depressing moments and seen the most unbelievable documentaries. But for me personally, your words were the most stirring ones. And I'm personally, and on behalf of this institution, most, most grateful to you that it was like that. I want to say two, three things about what stirred me most. In the beginning, when I was here with Chennai intellectuals, with all kinds of people, some people made comparisons between, I put it in a more general way, let's say leadership figures in the history of my country and your country, maybe more recent ones there. And I said, no, now please don't exaggerate, because as a German, you mentioned something about it, we feel something like the uniqueness of that genocide and Holocaust, what happened there.
You feel a sense of responsibility.
The more, the more I read, I discuss, I see, and also about the work here, the more stirring I find how many systematic similarities are there. Not maybe to 33 or even 42 or whenever the most frightening moments were, but to the time maybe immediately after the First World War, when slowly this began. And here and everywhere else, I suppose, this can always happen again. And what can we do against it? So that's the one stirring point. Another one, and that has to do, I told you briefly before that yesterday I had the honor to be the keynote speaker on another Founders Day in the Theosophical Society. And we spoke a lot about ultimate reality and these things. So if you think about not the ultimate reality, but the ultimate reality about ourselves, the humans, the humankind, and this dialectic of good and bad, how's all this sadism that you mentioned, how is it possible? You have it in me, I have it in me, if we are honest. It can happen to all of us. And then of course this huge question, what can you do against it? How can you protect yourself? And what can you actively do? And the last thing, not to be too long, I suppose that someone you have read Amitav Ghosh's book, The Great Derangement, where he also asked this question there for climate change. We know it all. Yeah. By the way, in 1988, a famous songwriter called Leonard Cohen made this song, Everybody Knows. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many of you know this song. Also there, Everybody Knows. So what paralyzes us so much? And here in your country, where you have this fantastic social movement and this collective consciousness that you are capable of doing the change. So these are some of the stirring moments. Thanks again, I will tell you personally also after that. It's a wonderful moment in the history of this institute. By the way, that for 56 years has been here, and I think always an open, critical, and safe platform. And that will remain like this.
Last question.
My name is Sriram Panchu. Mr. Mander, I want to thank you for a powerful and searing talk. I think it was reflected in the questions you had from the those assembled. My question is, where do you see the courts in protecting or failing to protect India's constitutional values?
That's a very specific question, and I think that we've had a mixed record, but there are high points and there are low points. I was describing Amir spending 14 years in jail for crimes that he had never committed. And then you see the one minister, one senior politician, one of the fewest across India in any communal riot who has been actually convicted of a crime, of which is Dr. Maya Kodnani in Gujarat, in the Naroda party, for having led the violence. Because I know the victims and I know how they fought. They used to speak to me and they said that this judge, and she was just Jyotsna Ben Yagnik, an ordinary civil judge. And they told me the day the judgment was coming out, before that I was very worried that they would be heartbroken. They had fought for so many years. And I said, you know, anything can happen. And they said, no, with this judge, we are sure about her fairness. And I was very touched by their confidence in her. And she gave a judgment which has no parallel, actually, where she also convicted her to 28 years in jail. But after the new government came to power in Delhi, she has been continuously on parole for the last 3 years. And she emerges sometimes in a yoga camp, taking a selfie, etc. She's not in jail at all after being convicted of a crime of leading the killing of the worst single massacre during Gujarat was in the Naroda party, where 110 people were killed. So you see that also happening with courts. By contrast, somebody like Amir, he was not even given a day's parole when his father died to attend the funeral. And she's been on parole for the last three and a half years. So we have a mixed record, and we see it at the highest level. There are moments when you say, wow, this is how we're holding on to our secular democracy. But I don't think that the clarity of conviction to what the Constitution very clearly desired is working out. Our judges are getting increasingly compromised. And the drama that we saw in the last couple of weeks is really a reflection of how you're taming the highest judiciary. So what you're placing people at that highest level, and you immediately are able to look for skeletons in their cupboards. The sad part, if they didn't have any skeletons, that would be wonderful. But the sad part is that they're able to find, with successive chief justices, they're finding the skeletons, and then those people are clearly behaving like in a very compliant kind of way. So it is, the judiciary is our most respected institution. A lot of surveys show that. But I think that they are also facing a threat. To the things that you spoke about, I just thought maybe we could end with that. I think your questions, thank you for your kind words. But I do believe the historical parallels with the build-up to what happened in Germany. Whenever I go to Berlin, I visit the Holocaust Museum and I look at the pictures there. And what I find most frightening is the pictures, black and white pictures of Jews being attacked and humiliated on the streets. And you see the faces of the crowds who are just watching. And it is exactly that which I'm reminded of in lynching after lynching. How do people just watch? And in virtually none of them are we seeing people who intervene. When Junaid's brothers were telling me when he got into this, they said they were sitting, when the crowd came in, and Junaid himself gave his seat to an old man. But the other brothers said, why should we give up our seats? And then there was this thing, then they started pulling off their beards, and then they took out knives. And they said everybody in the compartment was goading them to kill, including the old man to whom he had given a seat. Not one person came to protect him. You know, that story, that conversation gave me nightmares for a long time, and I wasn't able to sleep and so on. One night I suddenly remembered that I had read a similar story of something that had happened in Portland in the US. So I got into Google and I read this story. And what is extraordinary, and I'll tell you the story briefly. The story was that both happened during the month of Ramzan, two which were hate attacks on trains on Muslim, visibly Muslim teenagers. And yet the stories were, and in both knives came out and both people died, but the stories were as different from night to day. What happened in Portland was that two teenage girls, one of them was wearing a hijab, both were, one of them was colored, and they had gotten to this train. And when the train was proceeding, suddenly this middle-aged white man got up and he started verbally attacking them, saying, go back to, apparently, go to, here the place of destination is Pakistan, there it's Saudi Arabia. So he said, go back to Saudi Arabia and do this. And he said many things, and the girls were really terrified. But three different white men stood up and they came and they formed a ring around between the girls and them, and they said, you cannot do this. And the girls started, got up and started getting off, and they turn their heads, and what do they see? This white man, he takes his knife and he slashes one of them on the throat, he slashes the second one on the throat, and the third man, he is running, he slashes him on his thigh. The first was a college boy of about 23, and he collapsed, he started bleeding, and then at some point he said, I think I'm going to die. And his last words before he did die was, tell everybody on this train that I love them. And then the second man, he was an army veteran, and he went onto the platform and he died there. And then the third man, his life was saved, and he was also a young college man. And they, you know, the Muslims in America collected a huge amount of money, collected I think $1 million to honor him, and they. And when they had this function to honor him, he said two very beautiful things. He said, the whole country is rallying around behind us, but we don't need your protection. Who you should really be thinking about are those two girls who were subjected to that kind of hate attack. They're just teenagers. Rally behind them. Take care of them. This is what this boy said. And the second thing he said, you're making great hero of us, but what did we do? All we did was to protect our own children. To protect our own children. And I think that is the idea that I think, when I say Junaid was my son, that is the idea that I think, you know, how do we fight this? We have to fight this by looking at each other as brothers and sisters who belong with each other. And I think that is the only way we can fight this. Otherwise, we will end up with history, seeing our faces on photographs, now on videos, just watching while India is being unmade before our eyes. Thank you.
On behalf of CAG, I'd like to thank Mr. Harsh Mander for taking time out of his schedule and being with us for this lecture today. I'd like to thank Goethe Institute for hosting us and for making all the arrangements. I'd like to thank the audience for participating and for your questions. I want to thank the media for covering this event. And I want to thank the board and the team of CAG for organizing this event. Thank you once again.